the bounded linear functionals and the dual space. And the main example we discussed last time were the finite dimensional Rn and Cn with the LP norms. Okay, when that 1 less than p less than infinity only we discussed, but basically therefore finite dimensional. So what we would like to look at now is a set of examples, corresponding examples of bounded linear functionals on some infinite dimensional non-linear spaces. Okay, so that's what we are going to look at. And we do not know many infinite dimensional non-linear spaces. The only ones that we had seen examples are the LP and the space of all continuous functions. And in when you go to function, it involves a lot of measures and measure theory and all. So we'll restrict for the time being only to the sequence spaces. So what we would do is let P be a real number. I will note it in one place, 1 less than p less than infinity. Okay. And q the conjugate, and therefore 1 less than q less than infinity and 1 by p plus 1 by q equal to 1. This I'll after a few days you will get a couple of times if I write this you will get used to it. And this can also be written as pq minus p is q or pq minus q is p, any one of these ways you can write it. So I am going to look at a real number p such that p is between 1 and infinity, denote by q the conjugate, and then I consider the nonlinear space LPR. Now our analysis will be somewhat analogous to what we did last time, but we will see there are a few things that we have to sort out because we are in infinite dimensional spaces. Okay. What does this mean? So this is the set of all sequences, infinite sequences, such that every term is a real number and the summation mod xj to the power of p is finite. So by LPR I mean all those sequences, real sequences, such that the sum of the pth power of the terms is less than infinity, and we denote by the p norm this sum j equal to 1 to infinity mod x j to the power of p 1 over p. This is the example which you have seen when we saw nonlinear spaces. Okay. So we are going to look at this LP space. So and then we are going to look at linear functionals, bounded linear functionals and the dual of this space. Okay. So first of all, so this is first, consider, let's understand what is meant by a linear functional. Okay. Consider any linear bounded linear functional on LPR. Let me call it as capital F. Okay. Capital F on any bounded linear functional F on LPR. So that means F belongs to the dual space. What is the dual space? It is the collection of all bounded linear functionals. So I am going to look at one element in that space. Take any typical bounded linear functional on this space. So what does this mean? So typically what are all the things that I have when I say this? This means all the following. First of all, it is a functional. So it takes every element of LPR to a number. So f maps LPR to R. With each function is associates a number. That is what is meant by functional. With each element it associates a number. Secondly, it is linear. So F is linear. That means it preserves addition and scalar multiplication. So the vector space operations are preserved. And thirdly, F is bounded. That is that part. And what does that mean? That is, let us recall this, there exists an M such that if you look at mod fx, that will be less than or equal to M times the p norm of x. Fx is a number, so I should talk about its modulus, and x is a vector, so I should talk about its p norm. So mod fx is less than or equal to M times norm xp. So as I said, it works within some elastic limit. And the maximum of the damage is called the norm. And norm F is defined to be the supremum of mod Fx by norm Xp, x not equal to the 0 vector and x belonging to LPR. Okay? That is how the norm of the functional is defined. So these are all the things that I have with me when I say that F is a bounded linear functional on LPR, and in particular norm F with the smallest constant that satisfies this inequality, and therefore mod Fx is less than or equal to norm times F, norm of F times the p norm of F. So these are all the things that I have when I say that I have a bounded linear functional on LPR. Okay, functional, linear, bounded. Okay. All these facts are required. So from now on I will not write it. When I say this, this is the meaning. All these are granted. I may be changing LPR to some other space, so then you have to change that. But the ideas are the same. This is a functional, it associates a number, it's linear, it preserves superpositions, it's bounded, it takes, it's a nice continuous function or operates within certain limits. Okay. So I take a typical bounded linear functional on LPR. Now in the case of finite dimensions, suppose instead of infinite number of elements in this I had only n, then I was working in Rn. When I was in Rn, I said that any linear functional is completely captured by its action on the basis. Well, this statement is even true in infinite dimensions. If you have an infinite dimensional vector space, it will have a basis. By Zond's lemma, when he treated Zond's lemma in summer, we gave an example to show application of Zond's lemma to show that every vector space has a basis, and we called it the Hamel basis. Okay. So every vector space has a basis, and therefore the linear functional is captured by its action on the basis. However, when you are dealing with infinite dimensional spaces, the Hamel basis will be very big, can be very big, and in fact its cardinality could be as big as the original vector space itself, and therefore capturing it and then working with it is as good as working with all the values of the function. So, it is not a big advantage when you are dealing with infinite dimensional spaces, and particularly you are getting into analysis, it is not a big deal working with Hamel basis. So, we are going to mimic what we did in finite dimension space and see what will happen. Okay. So, with finite dimension space, what we did was we had a basis 1 0 0 0 1 0 0 0 1 etc. and we looked at the action of F on that. Now, let us copy that. We have 1 0 0 0 0 infinitely, then 0 1 0 0 0 0 0 1 0 0. Now, instead of finite number of those, I got infinite number of them. So, I want to do boldly jump into what I did in finite dimension, start doing that itself. So, let Ej belong to LP be the sequence whose jth term is 1 and all others 0. So, EJ is like this 0, 0, 0, and when he came to the jth one, it is 1 and again it goes on 0, 0, 0. It is obviously in LP, because to be in LP, some of the pth powers of the components must be finite. There is only one component and the pth power is going to be 1, and so there is no problem at all. So, it is obviously in LP and I am going to define like that. And if it is in LP, and what is its norm? What is its P norm? Yeah, it's 1. Okay, so there is no problem. So that's the easiest list. And in the finite dimension, I went and looked at what is the value that the functional takes at these points. Okay, that I will do again. So, since it is in LPR, let me write. Since it is in LPR and F associates a number with LPR elements, so F will associate a number with EJ. Okay, so therefore, FEJ is a real number. Let's denote it by fj. So fj is f of ej. Now how many such numbers do we get? We are going to get an infinite number of numbers. So I put that as a sequence. So now consider this sequence. Consider the sequence, yeah, whose terms are this F1, F2, F3, etc. In the finite dimensional case, I got n numbers again, and that was again a vector in Rn. But now, there is no reason for me to believe that this should be in LP. So, I don't even know where this fellow lives. See, this is where the problem we are stuck up with when you come to infinite dimension. I went and looked at every one of these EJs. I got hold of numbers. I formed a sequence. I don't know how that sequence behaves, whether it lives in the original space. I started with original space of sequences. So, unlike in finite dimensional nonlinear space, LPN, in this case, we do not even know. Now, I am writing all these things because I mean we should know what are all the type of difficulties that one would face when dealing with infinite dimensional spaces. We do not even know in which space of sequences, or shall we say to which space of sequences does this F belong? So, if you do not know, let us go and find out. Previously it was offered on a platter. When it was in finite dimensional space, we were offered it on a platter, n components, so it has to live n components, n real numbers, so it has to live on Rn. In Rn, any norm you can put, so you can put the LP norm, so it lived in LPNR. But now, we do not know. So, we have to decide where this fellow lives. We started with LPR. From the LPR, on that LPR, we had a functional. From that two combinations, I constructed a set of numbers, which is a sequence. No, I don't know anything about this sequence. I am going to analyze this sequence and figure out everything about that fellow. Okay. So, we shall now see where this f is. Yeah. Unfortunately, not in the vector space, because in the vector space algebraic structure only finite linear combinations are allowed. Infinite linear combinations are not allowed because there is no convergence. But now if you want to write it as an infinite linear combination, you have to now prove to me that that series converges in that space. And that's the thing that we are going to do. We don't even bother about it. We say, why do I worry? F is continuous, so I am going to work with that. Okay. So now I am going to look at the following simple thing. See, whenever you want to get into the realm of new knowledge, you always take your step from the known knowledge. Okay. We are always comfortable with finite dimensional spaces. So somehow or the other we will convert it to a simple problem in finite dimension, then pull it up. Okay. Now I have no reason what to do with a vector like this, it's living in infinite dimensions. So what I will do is I will kill many coordinates later. So therefore what I will do is I will keep only the first few coordinates and take all the other coordinates as 0. So what I will do is for any n, for any positive integer n, so given x in LPR, I am coming to your point now, given any positive integer n, let xn be equal to x1, x2, xn, same first n coordinates as the given x, but then subsequently it's all 0. Okay, so I truncate that vector beyond a certain stage, I kill it. But now this vector can be written as a linear combination of the n's. That's precisely why I want the. Okay, this I can do for every n. What are all the things that I know about xn? This clearly belongs to LP because the sum of all the coordinates to the pith power itself is finite. So this much will be finite. And secondly, this will converge to that in the norm, because the difference will have only the pth powers of the nth term onwards. If you take xn minus x and take this, it will come from n plus 1 to infinity, but that is the tail part of a convergent sequence. So therefore as n goes to infinity, that will go to 0. So that's the idea. Okay, so I will make several points here. Safest way of saying this clearly. Okay, that means fill up all the details. One, xn belongs to LPR, and two, xn tends to x in LPR, in the norm. Three, xn is equal to summation j equal to 1 to n xj each. All these are known. Okay. Now we will do whatever we did in finite dimensions. The moment I get to this finite linear combination, f of x will be taken term by term. So by linearity, so this is the first time I am going to use the linearity of f. The linearity of f, we get fxn is equal to summation j equal to 1 to n xj f of ej. I could not write x is equal to summation j equal to 1 to infinity xj ej. But I could write xn is equal to summation j equal to 1 to n xj ej. But f of ej is what I called as wherever it is fj. Okay. So this is going to be equal to summation j equal to 1 to n xj fj. Okay. So by linearity of f, I can say that for any n, f of xn is equal to summation j equal to n 1 to n xj fj. Is that okay? But now I use the fact f is bounded. If f is bounded, it is also continuous. Remember I said for linear transformation, boundedness, continuity at the origin, continuity at all points, all are equivalent. So therefore now I use the fact, but now by boundedness of f, see now here I use the fact that it is a functional to assume that f is a real number. Here I use the fact it is linear. Here I use the fact that it, now I am going to use the fact that it is bounded. So I am using the full power of f. It is a bounded linear functional. Okay. So because it is bounded, it must be continuous, which also meant that it should preserve convergence. All these terms meant the same. Boundedness, continuity at one point, continuity at all points, and preserving convergence. All these things mean the same for linear fellows. So now I have bounded, continuous, and preserves convergence. If it preserves convergence, what does that mean? Xn goes to x and therefore fxn must go to fx. Okay? And therefore, that implies since xn converges to x in LPR, it must preserve the convergence. We have fxn converges to fx. Now not as in LPR, now as numbers. Fxn is a number, fx is a number, so this is a convergence as real numbers. Okay? So f is continuous, f is bounded, it is continuous, therefore it is also preserving convergence. So whenever something goes in the LP space, the corresponding numbers that we got must also converge. Now what does that mean? Fxn is this. This must converge as n goes to infinity. So this series converges, and on the left hand side I get fx. So therefore star gives, I will I hope I can remember whatever I wrote here. So that so by star we get the series summation n equal to 1 to infinity xj fj converges to fx. So we can write f of x is summation or j equal to 1, summation j equal to 1 to infinity xj fj. So that is the thing we circumvented your question of linear, expressing things as linear combination. I could not express the vector x as an infinite linear combinations of the EJs. I could do it partially only up to certain terms and then others truncated out. And then I slowly moved into the limit, and luckily f was continuous and preserved convergence, so I could now get out of that difficulty. Okay? So this is where I very strongly use the fact of continuity of the functional f. If I did not have the continuity of the functional f, if I had only linear functional, this is false. F of x is equal to xj fj will be false. But because of the continuity of f, I am able to get f of x is equal to xj fj. So again it says, if you capture these numbers, I can capture the entire functional. See, now these numbers are much smaller in size than capturing f of all the Hamel basis elements. This is what is known as a shorter basis. We will come to these questions of what type of basis we are talking about. this is a different type of basis, this EJS, they are called Schroder basis. Okay. But as a just as a vector space concept of basis will not take you too far when you are dealing with infinite dimensional spaces. We should bring in the norm, we should bring in infinite representations, we should bring in convergence. Okay. So now we have got, therefore, this is true for every x in LPR. For every x we can do this. This is the crucial part now, first. So therefore, first thing that we have achieved is, go and look what f does to each one of these e1, e2, e3, e4, etc. Get those numbers. The moment those numbers are captured, f of x can be written as like this. Okay. But I still do not know where this sequence lies. But at least now I say that this sequence determines the functional completely. So the first thing that we know, hence we know now that this f equal to f1, f2, etc. completely determines the linear functional capital F. Nevertheless, we have still not answered this question, where do you belong? What sequence space are you in? Are you in LP, are you in LQ, are you in some L infinity, or probably none of these things are sitting in a very strange sequence space? And if so, I have to find out that world in which you are living. Okay. But we are yet to determine to which sequence space F belongs. So that is still not determined. That question is still open for us. Now we are going to move towards that slowly. Let us let me try various things now. Okay. I'm going to try very many things now test for something about that sequence F. Okay. Probably after seeing this twice or thrice, you will see why I do these things. Okay. So I'm going to construct some very special sequences to get a grip of this F. Okay. Let's see. First of all, so this is a very important thing which I will keep. Recall Fj is f of Ej. Okay. Now I am going to construct a very peculiar sequence so that when I evaluate f on that, it involves only the f's. So I want to get rid of this xj. For that, what should I do? So this xj, I will concoct it in a peculiar manner. So now consider, again for any n, yn, a new sequence, which is again y1, y2, yn, then 0, 0, 0. Again, I comfortably act only with finite fellows and then push to limit. Okay. Now, if that is the case, what will be fyn? I am going to construct this yj, so you will see why, where yj is the following. Of course, for j greater than n, yj is 0. So I have to worry only about for j between 1 and n. So I will define it to be 0 if fj is 0. If I want the value of y at a j, I go and look at what is this fj. if that fj is 0, I will put that also as 0. And if that fj is not 0, I will define it to be, you will see why. Why I wanted fj not equal to 0, because I am going to put it in the denominator. That is why I was very cautious about fj being not equal to 0. So what I will do is, I am going to construct a vector. Okay, I want to put some number here. Now if I want to put the first number, I go and look at the first number here. If that number is 0, I will put 0 here. If that number is not 0, I will put modulus of that number to the power of q divided by fj. This is for 1 less than or equal to j, less than or equal to n, 0 otherwise. Okay. Now, let us observe some points. Again, what is, because it has only a finite number of coordinates, it will be in LP, because that series will become a finite sum now, and finite sum obviously converges. So yn belong to LPR, whenever you have only finite number of coordinates non-zero, it will belong to any LP for that matter. So it belongs to LPR. So we will find out what is his p norm. For that I must find the jth coordinate to the power of p and add all the pth powers. Okay. So what is this? This is 0 if yj, fj is 0. Otherwise it is mod fj to the power of pq divided by mod fj, which is what? Mod fj to the power of pq minus p. I am taking the modulus and taking the pth power. So this will be pth power, that will be pth power of the qth power. So, and now I take this to the numerator. What is pq minus p? Q. So that is equal to mod fj to the power of q. Now I assumed here fj not 0. Now when I write it in this form, this is true even when fj is 0. So mod yn yj to the power of n to the power of p is fj to the power of q. So summation j equal to 1 to n mod fj to the power of q, right? I am adding from j equal to 1 to n. So what is norm of, therefore the norm of yn, the p norm, which is summation j equal to 1 to n mod yj to the power of p to the power of 1 over p, is the same as summation j equal to 1 to n mod fj to the power of q to the power of 1 over p. This is equal to this, so that 1 over p power as it is I am writing. Is that okay? So I have constructed a very special vector in LP whose pth norm is connected somehow to the qth powers of those fj numbers which I have calculated. So this is one thing I keep in mind. Now I am going to apply this star to this particular yn. F of yn will be what? By definition, that, remember, it holds for, this holds for any vector. So I am going to particularly apply for yn. So it will be ynj into fj. That is the important thing. Okay. For any vector x, now the value of f at that point can be calculated by multiplying by the fj coordinates. Now multiply by the fj coordinates. But conveniently, I have constructed this in such a way that this gets knocked off and I get only mod fj to the power of q. That okay? right? So now what do I get? So I have summation j equal to 1 to n mod fj to the power of q is equal to f of yn, and it's also mod f of yn. Why? Because it's all non-negative. Everything is non-negative. So when things are non-negative, modulus is the same as the original number. But now f of anything in modulus is less than or equal to norm of the f into that thing. So this is what we observed. Whenever I say I have a linear functional, f of anything is less than or equal to f of this. Okay? Now we have got everything now. We have the this thing I am going to substitute there. So therefore, summation j equal to 1 to n mod fj to the power of k is less than or equal to norm f. This is summation j equal to 1 to n fj to the power of q to the power of 1 over p. We have calculated the p norm of yn. Okay? All you have to do is bring it to this side. You get mod j equal to 1 to the power of 1 to n fj to the power of q to the power of 1 minus 1 by p. What is 1 minus 1 by p? 1 by q. So bring it to this side. So you get j equal to 1 to n mod fj to the power of q to the power of 1 by q is less than or equal to norm. Or I have summation j equal to 1 to n mod fj to the power of q is less than or equal to norm f to the power of q. And this is true for every n. I can do this yn construction for every one of the n's. I can do first for y1, then y2, then y3, then y4. This is true for every n. What does that mean? Here is a series of non-negative terms, and the partial sum sequence is bounded, and the partial sum sequence of non-negative terms is monotonically increasing. Every time I will be adding one more non-negative term only. So the partial sum sequence is monotonically non-decreasing and it is bounded above. Any monotone sequence non-decreasing bounded above must converge, therefore it is grand. Okay? True for every n. See, that's the nice part of analysis. You capture some simple ideas and bring them to that every time. Okay? And hence, summation j equal to 1 to infinity mod fj to the power of q converges and less than or equal to norm f to the power of q. This is the upper bound. It will converge to the least upper bound. So the least upper bound will be less than or equal to any upper bound. So finally, what does that mean? Therefore, I have captured f belongs to LQR. I was asking, where are you living? Where is this fellow f? Finally, I found out he is in LQR. F belongs to LQR and the Q norm of f is less than or equal to norm. This is the second important point I have observed. Okay. So therefore, what have we done? Given a bounded linear functional on LPR, first we captured some numbers called fj's, and then we showed those numbers completely determine the functional, and then we showed these numbers form a sequence which is in LQR. These are the three things that we have done. We somehow did some kind of digitalization of that functional, got hold of a sequence of numbers, and then she said this is a good digital because the functional can be reconstructed whenever you want. And then we said that the digital version we got lives in LQ. These are the three things that we have observed so far, and the digital version we got has a norm. That is at most the norm of the original functional you started with. So the size has not been very much increase or anything like that. The digital version also is having a reasonable price which does not exist the size of the original functional. In fact, we will show that is indeed equal to the same. The next thing is to show that the digital version and the original version share the same norm. The digital version in the space in which it lives, namely LQ, and the original version in the space which it lives, namely LP star, those two norms are the same. Okay. So, next, that is the next. So, so these are the three things that we have got so far. One is the numbers Fj, then the fact that the numbers capture the functional, and third that these numbers form an LQ sequence and the norm of the LQ sequence is not more than the functional. Yes.
Can you just repeat the last part, sir?
Okay. Now look at this series, right? When do you see the series converges? When the sequence of partial sums converge. This is the sequence, let us call it as sequence of partial sums of the series, sum of the first n terms. Okay. Right. So, you have a sequence of partial sums. Now, I want to make sure that sequence converges. For that, first I observe that the sequence is bounded. It is a fixed number. And that sequence is increasing because Sn plus 1 will add one more positive term. So, I have an increasing sequence bounded above and therefore it will converge to the least upper bound. This is one bound and the least upper bound will therefore be less than or equal to that bound. Is that okay? So, that is simple convergence of real numbers, okay, of infinite series. Infinite, first of all, again convergence we learn only for sequence. For series, we convert it to the convergence of partial sum sequence. Okay. And then convergence of sequences, the most important thing is monotone sequences. If it is going up, it should not, it should have a barrier beyond which it go to converge. If it is going down, it should have a barrier below beyond which it does not go. So, it is a very simple common sense idea. If we have a barrier, it goes to the closest barrier, the least upper bound. Okay. Okay. So, next our attempt to show that this is equal indeed. To show that is equal, all we have to do is to show the reverse inequality. So, now we have got this Fj's indeed live in LQ and therefore, this is in LP, this is in LQ, I can apply Holder's inequality. Okay. So, we have x belongs to LPR, f belongs to LQR and fx equal to summation xj Fj j equal to 1 to infinity, because that is what we are shown. And therefore, by Holder's inequality, mod fx which is equal to mod j equal to 1 to infinity xj fj will be less than or equal to the q p norm of x into the q norm of, that is simple Holder's inequality. That is why I said those inequalities are bread and butter in analysis. And therefore, what can we say about norm f? Yes, mod fx is less than or equal to m times norm x. Mod fx is equal less than or equal to m times norm x, and the smallest m is called the norm of the functional. So, therefore, norm f must be less than or equal to norm. Or in other words, you look at mod fx by norm x, that is the elastic limit, it cannot be more than the norm of f, and the ultimate limit elastic limit is called the norm of the functional. So, the norm of f is less than or equal to norm fq. So, from these two we get the next important observation, norm f equal to norm fq. Okay, so let us summarize. I will write the summary here, summary of our discussion so far. let us summarize all that we have done. We started with a functional f which was bounded linear. So corresponding to any f, instead of writing bounded, linear, functional, etc., I will simply write LPR star. Given any bounded linear functional on LPR, what did we show? We have shown that there exists a sequence. There exists a sequence f equal to f1, f2, etc., which belongs to LQR, such that one, the f is captured completely by these fj's, fx equal to summation j equal to 1 to infinity xj fj for every x in LPR, and the two versions of f have the same norm. The norm of f as a functional is the same as the norm of little f as a vector in LQ. These are the things that we have observed. Okay. So, what is the picture now? We have LPR star and then we have LQR. Given any f here, we have found a f there which does all these things. Okay. In other words, every linear functional as a translation, as a word in, if you think of linear functional as a word in the LP star language, it has a translation as a word in LQ language. Okay. So, in other words, we are constructing a dictionary. I understand the sequences better than thinking of functionals. So, I am trying to translate all these things into certain convenient language. So, now I have learnt that every fellow here has a translation there, and the translation is good in the sense it does not change in a way with the measure the size. Whether you measure the size here or whether you measure the size there, they are going to be the same. Okay. So, you can do the computations on the translated language also. And the second thing I observe is that if I have two fellows here, their sum will be identified to the sum there, because what? F of ej is fj, g of ej is gj, then f plus g of ej will be fj plus gj. So, therefore, the sum is also maintained. Scalar multiplication is also maintained, and therefore it is a nice linear identification. Superpositions are also preserved. In other words, if we have a sentence, you can do transliteration. Word for word, you can translate and go there. Okay. So you can either complete the sentence and then translate, or translate every word and then construct the sentence there. It's going to be the same. Okay, so this transformation is linear and it is also 1-1. Why? Because if fx equal to gx, this means f also go to the same thing. If f goes to this and g goes to this, and if f is equal to g, when can that happen? If f is equal to g, fj xj is the same as gj xj for every x, therefore f and g will be the same function. So therefore, this fellow is a good translation. That you don't play for with words like the politician. They will say something, so I didn't mean that. Actually what I meant was, it's beautiful to watch the TV debates, because we don't know finally what they meant. Okay, right. So eventually, therefore, but here there is no confusion. Every word has only one meaning. Okay. So if we now define T mapping LP R star to LQ R as T of F is the little f that we construct from every f. From everywhere, you evaluate at Ej, you get those numbers, construct that sequence is the identification. Then T is 1 1 linear 1 1 non preserving okay, but we do not know whether this language identification is complete in the sense there may be some words here which are not the translations of. I know every word here can be translated now, but I don't know whether every word here is the translation of somebody there. What does that mean? We don't know whether this map is onto. Okay, and next is to show that it is onto. Okay, we next show, it's very easy. We next show T is onto. What do you gain if we show T is onto? That means it's a perfect code. Everybody here, every functional can be coded as a vector in LQ, and every word in LQ is the code of some functional. Okay, so backwards, if you had something there, you will find a fellow there. So there is nothing like there are fake messages. Okay, every message is the coded one. Every message here is the code of some message here, and vice versa. Every message here has a code there. So instead of working with LPR star, you can as well work with LQR. That is the identification. Okay, so if this is done. Then LPR star, this non-preserving is what we call as isometry. The metric is the same. Okay. Then LPR star is isometry means non-preserving. Linear 1-1 onto is called isomorphism, vector space. This is the non-linear space language. This is the vector space language. This is the nonlinear space, norm is preserved. This is the vector space arithmetic is preserved. Isomorphism onto is isomorphic to LQR. So therefore, we will simply say LPR star is equal to LQR. As LQR. Okay. It's only LQR written in some other language. Okay, that language is this identification. Okay, so how do I do? This suggests how to do it. Given an f, first define this. This is defined. Why this is defined? F is in LQ, x is in LP, Euler's inequality says it is finite. So therefore, that's a number. Call that number as f of x. Go backwards. Previously, we knew f. We constructed the fj. Now I know fj, straight away I can write that sum, because by Euler's inequality it is a finite sum. That sum is a number, that number is what I call as fx. The rest of the game is simply follow the same procedure, verify it is linear, verify it is bounded, verify that it is norm. Okay. So simply define all we have to do this. All we have to do is observe one summation j equal to 1 to infinity given any f in LQR one summation j equal to 1 to infinity fj xj converges for every x in LPR by holder, then therefore define f mapping LPR to R as f of x equal to summation j equal to 1 to infinity xj fj. 3. Verify f belongs to LPR star, that is bounded linear, and norm of f is equal to norm of f cube. Okay, same arguments will help you, and you get, you have to practically reverse. Previously we didn't know where f was, little f was, we used the properties of capital F. Now we know where f is, we prove the properties of capital F. So simply reversing the steps, much easier, because previously we struggled hard to show where little f is. Now that's given on a platter, so the rest of the game is easy. Okay, so therefore now we have, hence we write for 1 less than p less than infinity, LPR star is equal to LQR. And LQR star will be LPR. Whenever we put some index here, its conjugate goes there. So therefore, what will be the double star of this? It will be itself. Therefore, LPR conjugate conjugate dual dual will be LPR itself. We call such spaces as reflexive spaces. The double dual is identified with itself, they are called reflexive spaces. Okay. Now, what I will do now is, I'll just give the next example, make one or two comments, and then give a idea of what we are up to next. Okay. Now, next case is p equal to 1, that is L1R. Okay. You are looking at L1R. Previously, you looked at 1 less than p, less than infinity. Now we are going to the case p equal to 1. So, what is L1R star? Analogous to what we had, I will do probably most of it next time. We can show, every time I will prove one important theorem and then sort of show what is coming up. Okay. We can show that L1R star is L infinity R, which is also along the same lines roughly, right? 1 by p, when p equal to 1, 1 by p plus 1 by q must be 1. Already 1 by p is 1, so 1 by q must be 0, which is q must be infinity. So intuitively this seems to be okay, right, when p equal to 1, and the answer turns out to be correct. It's not difficult, the proof is much simpler, almost along the same lines. First of all, given f, construct those numbers fj, same, look at fej, and show that those numbers are in L infinity R, and the norms tally, and reverse, start with anything here, define them to be fj xj, and show that defines a bounded linear functional. The idea is the simply the same as what we do in LPR, but it is much simpler, the proof is much simpler than before, but the line of thinking is the same. Things may come out much faster, but the line of thinking is the same. Okay. Then the last case we are still not done is p equal to infinity, but L infinity star is not L1. Okay. L infinity star is not, that is the case that creates, that is why I dealt with this 1 and infinity separately. So L1R is not reflexive. If I take double dual, it will come to, see the L infinity star is much more complicated. It involves some measure ideas. So we will keep it for those only who know some measure theory or something about additive set functions. Okay. So that is a much more complicated stuff. Okay. So, and therefore L1R double star is not equal to L1R, therefore L1R is not reflexive. Okay, now why this big fuss about reflexive and all, we will see later. Essentially, of all the structures to work with, the Hilbert space structure is the best one. We will see the geometry of orthogonality is brought through as some kind of a dot product. The Hilbert space structure is the best place to work, where you have analysis, you have geometry, we have vector spaces, all the things are available to us. So we use the power of all our structures, algebra, analysis and geometry, and try to get answers. Okay. And essentially, quote unquote, we can extract the proof in the right language to say that this also can be more or less done in reflexive spaces, if it was reflexive. Okay. So therefore, these are the two next best. If you are not lucky to be working in a Hilbert space, the next best thing to work with will be a reflexive Banach space. Okay. So that is the next alt. But if you are not in either of them, yeah, you got to work a little harder, more analysis is needed, and so on and so forth. Okay. Yeah. Any question? This is? This is not equal to L1R, correct. Sorry. Yeah. Yeah. Yes, that is what I am going to, just about to say that. All the same proof. Guys, we are just putting modulus, that is all. There are real or complex, Holder's inequality is the main thing. It holds even in the complex case. So, this, all this verbatim, except that I said this is a real number. There we have to say it is a complex number. Holds. Okay, let me put it that way. Holds if R is replaced by C. There is absolutely no change in the proof. Yeah. Any questions? So these are the ground state examples. Okay, these must be thoroughly understood. And the thing is, somehow or the other, people would try to convert the problems, complex problems, into these space languages. Okay, essentially, we will come back to this. See, in particular, here you assume that if P equal to 2, LP star is LP itself. P equal to 2, P equal to 2, LP, okay, I will not write now, R, or you can put R or C. L2 star is L2 itself, and that is the Hilbert space thing. See, the Hilbert thing is immediately it collapses, folds into the same thing. The reflective thing is the next stage it closes into itself. The more time, then afterwards you are going to be in trouble. Okay. The Hilbert space thing closes in the first starring itself. The reflexive thing is the second starring it folds back. Okay. Now, what's coming up? Okay, so let's look at one of the fundamental theorems in functional analysis is what is known as the Hahn-Banach theorem. Okay. I am not yet there. I want to see why I want at least some situations where I want this. Okay. The idea is the following. Suppose I have a Banach space. Suppose I had a nonlinear space. Let me call it as N. I wanted to write as X. And but then I wanted symbols, I was struggling how to get symbols, so therefore I changed Probably I could have written x, yeah. So suppose n is a nonlinear space. So I, let me write carefully the norm of n with a suffix, because I am going to use a number of nonlinear spaces. Okay, all right, I won't use it. I will make writing simpler. This is a nonlinear space. The moment I have a nonlinear space, I have its dual, right? So by the side of it, there is a dual, and the dual norm I will write with a star, so that it is clear that I am talking about the dual norm. Okay. And then the dual being a nonlinear space, it has a dual. So that is the second dual. Next, the second dual. Okay. Think of what some celestial bodies. This fellow, through this, yeah, this obstruction will cast a shadow here. Okay. This, what does that mean? Okay. So the shadow is cast by that. So in this shadow, this fellow will also come into the picture, this fellow also will come into the picture, like the moon and the earth and the sun and so on and so forth. Okay. Now what do I mean? What I mean is, for every fellow here, there is a fellow here, which I, whom I will call it as f of x. And this f of x comes through this, so there is linear functionals involved in this identification. Okay. So therefore, that shadow is there in the second. What we are saying is, essentially, if it is a complete total eclipse, full shadow, then that is reflexive. Okay. That is what the space, the full thing is covered by shadow. So, what, how do these things happen? So, the given, okay, first of all, what is meant by somebody is in N star? Let us note down all these things. Suppose somebody is in this star, again, what all that I wrote, somebody is in the dual place, means, first of all, he is a functional, so he maps N to or C. You can again replace R by C, real and complex, both are same statements can be made. Okay. So, that means first of all is a functional, then F is linear, then F is bounded, and the norm of F is, now this norm is in the star space. So, the norm of F star is the supremum of mod fx divided by norm of x. Where is this x? It is in n, so there is no more subscript, as x not equal, x belongs to n, x not equal to the 0. This is what all the things that we mean by saying f is in n star. Okay. The next thing is, now, I am going through all these things because, you know, eventually we are going to look at a variety of types of convergence. There is something called strong convergence or norm convergence, there is something called weak convergence, there is something called weak star convergence. So, when you are trying to do approximations in any problem, optimization or something, you somehow hope that it somehow this converge. Okay. Maybe it converges strongly, maybe it converges weakly, maybe it converges weak star, or subsequence converges nicely. Somehow or the other, I want to get my approximation to go somewhere and then verify that somewhere is the solution that I want. Okay. So therefore, these are all very important in getting into various notions of convergence. Now, F belongs to, I'll write this, keep this in mind, okay, this is, I'll write this specifically because I always found there is a lot of problem in with students in understanding this in the beginning. Afterwards it becomes no problem because there is a lot of confusion. So now I'll write, see, I will use the script notation for elements in double star, F for elements in n star, and I will use x, y, z for little, so lowercase letters for elements in n. So elements in n lowercase, elements in n star uppercase, elements in n double star script. Okay. What does this mean? This means F is a functional on n star. So therefore, I have to now write correspondingly now F maps n star to R to F is linear and 3 F is bounded. Now what is the norm of F mean? It's a double, the norm in n star double star denoted by the suffix double star. What is that? It is supremum of mod of F of what? F divided by norm of F what? Star, good. F belonging to n star, F not the zero element, I will call it a theta star, not the zero element, zero functional, okay. So this is what the chain is, okay. I have these vectors, the vectors are converted to numbers by these functionals. These functionals are converted into numbers by these functionals, double functionals, okay. This is something which you always keep in mind, this picture. I have n, n star, n double star. Anybody here convert these fellows to numbers. Anybody there converts these fellows to numbers. And all these things are maintained. Now, the important thing is, we are interested essentially here from the shadow, because this is the starting point. Those fellows here which are somehow connected with these guys are relevant to us. The other guys are not of interest because my original study is the space n. Things which are not connected with n, I am not interested in a sense, okay. So this is the first result which we will look at. Given any x in n, there exists an F which depends on x in n double star, that is the shadow. For every x in n, there is a shadow point in Fx, such that, okay. Now again, I want the shadows to be right translation language again. Point to point, linear, superpositions are preserved, norms to be preserved, okay. So we want such that, question, okay, such that, this is easy. Fx is x to fx identification is linear, preserves superpositions, okay. So that is vector space structure is preserved, the shadows preserve the superposition. Two, question mark. Not only that, we must preserve, we want the sizes to be preserved, so the norms to be preserved, such that, so I would like to have fx double star. I would like that after the shadow is formed, that shadow has the same metric. In that set, that fellow uses some metric, this fellow uses some metric, finally both of them come up with the same number. What do we want here? One is less than or equal to, the other one is greater than or equal to. Both are satisfied, it will be satisfied. If that is so, what it says is, we can now, as we march along, we can completely bring and embed it here. We can identify n as a part of n double star. We can identify n as a part of n double star, because the shadow is known, the translation language is known, all the arithmetic that we do we can do here, and lengths are not changed. So practically everything that we do there we can do in the language of n double star. But the only problem may be there are other things in n double star. So whether it is a total eclipse or a full eclipse, we do not know. If it is a total eclipse, what we say is it can be completely identified there, and therefore we do not have to go on starring anymore. We are back with what we started with. These are the three steps that we have to keep track of. X, n, and n double star is back to n. So x and n, n and n star are the only two important things in this space. So the linear space, the non-linear space, and the functional space. These are the only two things that one has to study. Okay. So now, first of all, we will see how to define this, and then when we go along, and this is the place where the Hahn-Banach theorem will be required to show that this identification is norm preserving, that metric is also preserved. Okay, so, and that is where the first major requirement for Hahn-Banach theorem is. Now, we will see that Hahn-Banach theorem is not a very complicated theorem. If it is a very simple theorem, it simply says that we always, whenever we want to do something in non-linear space, as far as possible, particularly with functionals, as far as possible, preserve superpositions and preserve norms. Okay, this is two mantras we should keep in mind. When you are doing something with linear functionals, as far as possible preserve linearity and preserve norm. And that's exactly essentially what Hahn-Banach theorem says. In a particular situation this is possible. Okay, and that together, that theorem together will say this is possible. If this is possible, then we say that this is embedded into this. If we collect all the fx's in that part is essentially x. So in the n double star, there is a big portion which is n rewritten in a different language. He has infiltrated there. The n has infiltrated in the n double star in a disguised form. That is all there is to it. Okay. And if you are completely infiltrated, n double star falls off in the hands of n himself, and he is just n. Okay. So we will in next time start with this identification. See, there are lots of convergence here, there is a convergence here, there are convergences here. All these can be combined to get varieties of notions of convergence. There is, you can talk about convergence in terms of the norm in n, the norm in n star, the norm in n double star, put them, mix them all up, and see what are all the types of convergences that we can talk about. So our next scheme is to look at this second dual and this embedding. Okay, that is what is known as the natural embedding of x into x double star, because we do not know whether it is onto. Sometimes it is onto, sometimes it is not onto. So the natural embedding of x, n into n double star. Okay, that will, that I will stop here.